Shabba, it's Sam, back with another Swift 3 screencast. In this tasty morsel of information, I'm going to take a look at how Swift 3 imports C APIs and how that differs from Swift 2. This entire screencast is based around a single new feature, NS Swift Name. You use NS Swift Name in your C and Objective-C APIs to be able to specify what these things should be called when they're imported into Swift. This has been supercharged in Swift 3. Now, I'm not actually going to look at NS Swift Name, but actually look at the effects it has on Grand Central Dispatch and Core Graphics. To start out, I'm going to take a look at GCD and the beautiful new API that you get provided simply because of the use of NS Swift Name. So creating a queue now uses the dispatch queue type, and you provide a label, a quality of service, attributes, auto release frequency, and target, most of which have sensible defaults. So here I'm just going to provide the QoS and the label. And that means I can get rid of all of this crap up here, and I've got a much, much nicer way to create a dispatch queue. Using that queue, rather than using this global function, I can now use the async function on the queue itself, which just takes a closure. Work items are new, and they represent a unit of work. It's kind of a wrapper around a closure, and in fact, you can create a work item using a closure. Work items are quite cool. They're cancelable, and you can manage various other bits and pieces about work items. To add them to a queue, you once again use a queue async method, and this time pass the work item to the execute argument. Dispatch barriers used to use the dispatch barrier async or dispatch barrier sync method. Now, once again, you use the async or sync methods on the queue, providing flags. Here, the dispatch work item flag barrier will do what you want it to do. Once again, that just takes the closure that represents that barrier work item, that barrier task. Dispatch groups used to use dispatch group create. Now dispatch group is a type in its own right, so you can instantiate a dispatch group. In order to dispatch work onto one of those groups, you once again use the queue async with the group argument. So I'm going to provide the group with queue async, and then the execute is once again a closure. And the notification of a group, dispatch group notify, has been replaced with a method on the group itself. So group.notify takes a queue. I'm going to use the main dispatch queue, which is just a static property on the dispatch queue type. And once again, just pass a closure. After using GCD's Swift 3 API, it doesn't take long for you to completely forget how to write GCD in Swift 2. And hence, I guess, C. Treating queues, groups, and work items as actual physical types makes life worlds apart easier. It really is great. Next up then is Core Graphics, which has had a similar treatment, once again just using NS Swift Name. First up, I'm going to take a look at a function which performs some kind of transform using CGAffine transform. In the past, lots of global functions, but now instance methods on the affine transform itself. This function here, doAFunkyTransform, takes a starting point and returns a CGAffine transform. First thing to note is that the identity is now a static property on CGAffine transform itself. Rather than using these horrible CGAffine transform rotate global methods, these are now instance methods on the affine transform itself. So, for example, I can do the starting point rotated by pi times 3 by 4. Notice there that pi is now a static property on CG float, or in fact, part of the floating point protocol. Then I can scale it, and finally I can translate it. Notice that because all of these are now instance methods on the CG affine transform, this becomes a completely fluent API, and I can just return the result of these chained operations. CG contexts have had exactly the same treatment as CG affine transform, which once again means all of those global free functions where you pass in a context have now been turned into instance methods on the context itself. I've got some Swift 2 code that uses Core Graphics to render a circle. You can see how much nicer this is once you move this into Swift 3 and you can use a CG context as an actual object. I'm going to recreate these five lines that actually do the drawing in the middle. As with the affine transform, these are now all methods on the CG context itself. So here, set fill color. I can specify the color in the same way that I did before. Notice that yellow color has become a static property and has been renamed yellow, and that CG color is now lower camel case. We do the same with set stroke color, UI color orange CG color. and set the line width as well, also in that context. Then the context, I can add an ellipse in the rectangle in the same way as before, before finally using the context draw path using fill stroke. Now I've done that, I can delete all of these original lines, makes a much nicer, easy to understand process. And if I just check the result, you'll see that it is indeed a yellow circle with an orange border. Just before I bring this screencast to an end, I'm going to go slightly off-piste, out of the world of core graphics and into UIKit. If all you want to do is use some core graphics to draw an image, it's a real pain in the ass that I've got to set up a context, do my drawing, extract the image from the context before finally completing that context. New in iOS 10 is the introduction of a UI graphics image renderer. This does all of the setup and teardown of the core graphics context for you, leaving you just to do the drawing. It's so much easier. This new rendering API is incredibly easy to use. We no longer have to manage our own context. So I'm going to start off by creating one of these UI graphics image renderer. And for that, you can either provide a bounds or a size. So I'm going to go with the size of, same as before, 210 by 210. Then I'm going to create the UI image using the renderer image actions method. This just takes a closure in which you get provided a UI graphics image renderer context. Notice that this isn't the same as a CG context, but it includes a reference to the CG context. And if I'm going to pull that out now by using let context equal image renderer context.cg context. Now that I've got that context, I can copy all of the drawing code into this closure. This context isn't optional, so I just need to remove some question marks. And now UI image will be the same UI image that I used before. Only this time, I didn't have to manage any of the context myself. There it is, yellow circle with an orange border. And that's pretty much everything I want to show you in regards to the new import of C APIs into Swift 3. Remember that all of this uses the supercharged NS Swift name. If you've got C APIs that you need to import into Swift, I suggest you take a look at it. You can do all of this stuff and the compiler just treats it as those low-level functions. There's no runtime magic going on here at all. It's all compiled down to those raw global functions. I do hope you've enjoyed this screencast, and I think out of all of the Swift 3 ones, this is the one that's going to make your life so much easier. Thanks ever so much for watching. I shall see you, kind of, through a camera, again later. Love you loads. Bye-bye.